Welcome to another real estate market update for the city of Phoenix. For the last month, we had something happen for this first time that's never happened before. Our Crawford Market Index went over 500. We're 513.5. Now, historically, going back as far as 2005, we never broke the 360 mark. And late last year, we broke the 360 mark. As a matter of fact, we got to 400, and now we just hit 500 for the first time ever. What does that mean? If you look at the market index, usually we're looking for about 100, because if it's 100, it's a balanced market. If it's below 100, what that means is a buyer's market, like we had back in 2009, 2010, 2011. Now, we're not in just a seller's market, we are an extreme seller's market. You can look at it for every one seller, we've got about five buyers, right? So how does this play out? The way it plays out for our market is we've never had as low inventory as we do today. So looking this morning, we had about 4,000 homes for sale in our MLS, which if you look historically, we're looking for about 30,000 homes, right? 30,000 homes in the Phoenix market is about a balanced market. You know, we have about 5 million people. So active listings at the beginning of March, we have 4,491, which is down 59% back from 11,000 this time last year, and down 13% from 5,200 just this last month. Under contract listings, we have 12,600 properties under contract as it stands beginning of March versus 12,000 last year, which is up 5%, not a huge deal, but up 9% from 11,600 just this past month. Monthly sales, we had 8,000 total closed for the month of February versus 7,500 last year. Again, not a big jump, just 7% higher, but up 9% from 7,300 last month, which if you recall, January was one of the busiest Januaries we've ever had. And so we had a busier month in February, which is fewer business days than we had in January. What does this mean as far as property values? The monthly average sales price per square foot was $228 for the month of February. That's up 23% from 185 this time last year, and up 5% from 217 this past month. If you could just think about it, 5% month over month property appreciation. It's really difficult to even imagine. And our monthly median sales price is $349,000, which is, you know, across the country, not that big a deal. But if you compare it to $295,000 last year, we're up 18% year over year in the median sales price. And $339,000 last month was a record. Last month, $339,000, we're up 3%, $10,000 month over month in median sales price. It's not very encouraging if you're trying to buy a home right now. Now, in March of 2020, Michael Orr talked about how we had a lack of supply. It was really difficult, right? So this is March of 2020 last year. Supply is now down 60%, almost 60%. And the best way he could describe this is scorched earth, which, you know, I love that term. Monthly sales count, pending counts, under contract counts, they're all higher than last year, but not by much. And so what that tells us is that downward trend in demand is actually occurring. Why is that happening? As people continue to get beat up in the market, they've just given up on trying to buy a home. So the demand's going down, not because people don't want to buy a home, they've just given up on the ability to buy a home. You look at this, it's very much like the unemployment rate, right? The unemployment rate usually, once it gets kind of high, is artificially low because people have just given up looking for jobs. Well, in this case, people have just given up trying to buy a home. The biggest thing that drives up prices is multiple offers. So we still have a lot of multiple offer situations, but as right now, in order to meet the necessary demand or supply to get to meet the demand that we've got, we would have to increase the demand or supply by 7 times. Okay, we got 4,000, we need about 28,000 to 30,000 to have a normal supply. Why is this important? Because right now you're hearing a lot of people talking about how there's this moratorium. And once the moratorium's over, once the forbearance ends, we're gonna have this flooded inventory. And once we have this flooded inventory, of course prices are gonna go down, which in a vacuum, that makes total sense. But in reality, if the prices go, if all those forbearance homes, all those moratoriums, of all that foreclosures, preventions ended, and every single one of those houses hit the market tomorrow, we would still have not enough houses to sell in the Phoenix market. That's how crazy we are right now. So anytime anyone's talking about this forbearance, just don't buy that pipe dream, at least not in Arizona, maybe in other parts of the country, but not in Phoenix. And then a lot of people are comparing it to like the, you know, the crisis we had back in 2007, 2008. So just for historical perspective, here's what I want you to look at. Anytime someone's telling you we're about to have another bubble, just like we did before, here are some facts you can share with them. First, the active listing supply increased dramatically from April 2005 to December 2006 because of all the building from all the speculation, right? Like, we were crazy up to 2004. All the builders started building more homes to meet this demand, but the demand wasn't there as much as they thought it was. And so prices started to fall in July 2006 because we had more supply than we did demand. Then, because the prices were going down, people had zero or negative equity from 2007 moving forward. And if your equity is going down, what motivation do you have to save your house? And so foreclosures started increasing in 2007, and homes were being abandoned due to lack of equity. And because of that, we had a huge wave of bank-owned properties hitting the market in 2008 and 2009, adding to the existing supply problem. And the reason why we hit this point is that a lot of people think that we're going to have this housing crisis because of foreclosures. In reality, when we had our last recession, the foreclosures occurred because we had too much supply. If we didn't have too much supply, all those foreclosures would not have happened, right? People look at this in the wrong order. And so the lack of equity meant homes listed in 2008 through 2011 were predominantly short sales, which this is when Matthew Potter and I partnered up to work on all the short sales. And then at that time, investors pounced on the bank-owned homes, all the short sales, from 2009 through 2011. And that's the reason why prices stopped dropping in 2011. So this situation is nothing like the last situation. People keep trying to compare it. It's nothing like it. Foreclosures did not cause the housing crash. It was a consequence of excess supply. Right now, we do not have excess supply. And so what are some other things to look at here? For beginning of March, the listing success rate across all areas and types just set a new record high of 92%, meaning every 100 homes they put in the market, 92% of them sold, or 92 out of the 100 sold. That is very unusual. Historically speaking, we look at for every 3 homes put in the market, 2 of them sell, right? 66% success rate. We're at 92. And this being at 90 plus, we don't see this continuing. We don't see this lasting, but something to monitor. And if we ever dip below 80%, at that time, we need to start looking and say, hey, maybe, you know, demand is starting to slow down too much. Another thing for the doomsayers who say, like, you know, we get this crash that's about to happen. Don't forget that rent was going down as prices were going up, right? So if it was cheaper to rent than it was to buy, then for a lot of people, it made sense to keep renting. Right now, you don't have any other options. Either you're renting or you're buying it. Either way, you know, market values have gone up 23% year over year, but rent has also gone up 22%. So it's damned if you do, damned if you don't. It's either you rent or you buy. Either way, you're paying more money, or you're just gonna be homeless. You know, that's not a good situation. So overall, what are we seeing here? If you're looking to buy right now, 44% of homes that are listed, or 44% of homes that are sold, closed for over asking price, which is kind of crazy to think about. And the average or the median difference was about $10,000. So if you were selling a home between $250,000 and $400,000, that meant that 52% were selling for over asking price. If you were between $400,000 to $800,000, 42% of those sold for over asking price. If you're even $800,000 to a million, 30% went over asking price. If you're going from 1.5 to 2.5 mil, 20% sold for over asking price. And even if you're over 2.5 mil, they're selling for the median $150,000 over asking price. It's absolutely crazy. And then for the past 6 weeks, we've added about 2,000 new listings per week to the MLS, which that might sound like a lot, but at the same time, we've been contracting 2,300 per week. So you can see what that's going to do to the supply. And actually, if you look at it historically, a normal is 2,500 new listings per week. We are dreadfully low. This is the lowest it's ever been in the 20 years that we've tracked this metric. And let's see what else is there. Demand, still 35% above normal. It's slowing down. We said demand's kind of going down. What that means is instead of having 25 offers on property, we're only gonna have 15 offers on a property. So there is really not a lot of hope for buyers. And then the average mortgage rate went up to 3%. So, you know, those that were waiting for prices to go down just watched their payments go up for the same exact house because interest has gone up. And so if you look at it, you know, logically, a family making a median income can only afford less than 60% of what's selling, right? 40% of homes are not even available to them. So they're available to afford 60% of the homes, but you got to put it into perspective. We got a lot of people coming here from California, and in California, what they're used to is 9 into 11% of them are able to buy something affordable for them. So this is a really cheap market, relatively speaking. It's kind of crazy to think about how cheap our market is compared to California, but that's the reality. That's the reason why our numbers keep going up, or as far as prices keep going up, and we see no signs of that slowing down. If you need help, reach out to us, studyinghomes.com, get a Studying Homes Realtor. We can help you either get the most out of your home when we're selling it, looking out for pitfalls, or as a buyer, able to get your offers accepted, because right now, there are a lot of agents complaining, and we just get stuff done.